It's a real pleasure and honor to be here today. This year marks the 50th anniversary of Unix. So Unix was born in 1969. 2019 is 50 years of life, and I think we should be thankful to those men and women that developed the system over the last 50 years and gave it the form we will decide. A lot has happened over the past 50 years, so 50 years is a really long time, through the 70s, 80s, 90s, 2000s, 2010s. And the question is, how has the architecture of Unix evolved over this time period? From Thompson and Ritchie programming on a PDP 11 through a teletypewriter of all things in the 1970s, to Bill Joy and the Berkeley Computer Science Research Group team hacking Unix on a VAX in the 1980s, to this century's modern open source communities. I will discuss the history of Unix. I will then present the data sources that we use together with Paris and Gary, which is joint work, to look at the architectural design decisions that happened over this half century. Then I will present quantitative results, which we measured over its evolution. And based on those two things, so a qualitative analysis and the quantitative results, our attempt to form an initial theory of operating systems evolution, architectural evolution. So let me start with the history. Unix was born in the famous AT&T Bell Labs. Some of us do not appreciate what happened there, but they're really phenomenal in what advances lay behind them. No less than 8 Nobel Prizes, 3 Turing Awards, radio astronomy and cosmic radiation was discovered there. The transatlantic phone cables, they were instrumental in laying out the transatlantic phone cables. The transistor, the charge coupled device, what powers our phones, cameras. Mathematical theory of communication, lasers, solar cells, of course the C, C++, and awk programming languages, fiber optics, and TDMA, CDMA multiplexing, and of course Unix. All this out of Bell Labs, which depended a lot, of course, on the largesse of AT&T, which had the United States monopoly in terms of phones. Unix started its life from another, through a failure, a system called Multics, which was developed in the 1960s through a collaboration of the MIT, AT&T Bell Labs, and General Electric. This was a large, probably overambitious system, and at some point Bell Labs realized that the progress was not what it wanted to be, so they pulled out of this effort. And at that point, Ken Thompson, Dennis Ritchie, and Doug McIlroy, and Joe Sana were left without the research that they were doing. They went off and then developed an unnamed system on a PDP-7, this machine you see here, a machine with very little power. However, this was relatively successful, the ideas that they embodied. And so based on that work, they created a funding proposal. So internally, they asked for funding, just as we do today from research agencies. And they asked for internal funding for PDP 11 in order to create a word processing facility, of all things, because Bell Labs was writing patents and it would be useful to have word processing facility. What followed has been very long and complex. We will follow in the next minutes this orange path, but there are interrelationships among various systems that were developed, so looking at one path that doesn't lose a lot, we don't lose a lot in terms of generality. Regarding the data sources we used for this research, they come from 4 areas. One is a repository, which is based on a release that was made by Caldera, the owners of AT&T proprietary code at some point in the early 2000s, which released out all AT&T source code up to a point, up to the 5th edition. Some of it wasn't even available in a machine readable form, but only as memos and typewritten documents, which volunteers transcribed into computer code. And based on that, I create the GitHub repository, you can find it here, which is synthetic, so no Git was available at that time. But I recreated a Git repository that follows Unix from PDP 7 edition to 7 research editions, things that happened at Berkeley, things that happened in open source distributions, until and including FreeBSD. can see here the various editions and code that moves from one edition to the other according to Git. So if you run Git blame, you can actually find code that was written by Dennis Ritchie in 1979 in modern FreeBSD together with code that was written in 2009. This is actually the earliest surviving code I found. The timeline of these releases is depicted here. So at the beginning I had snapshots. Later on people were using real version control systems such as SCCS and later CVS and Subversion. So these are actually directly imported to Git. The second source code is various books that we looked detailing the design of the kernel and the parts of the system. The third is manuals, some of which, such as those two, I read typeset from the machine readable form. It was a really interesting experience to see code that was formatting code that was written in the 1970s come alive again as through NROF and TROF. And the fourth source, based on those manuals and the others that are already available, is a data set containing the evolution of Unix facilities, which means that for every category of facility, such as user commands, system calls, C library functions, devices, and special files, we have a database laying out when each one was first available, in which release. You can see that in this rendering that which is available on the web, and when if it disappeared. Based on this database, we created a list of about 500 architectural design decisions. And after a lot of debate between Paris and myself, we agreed on the 50 most important ones, which I will describe later on. So let us move on those architectural design decisions. What happened over this lifetime? What were the major architectural milestones of Unix? I start with the milestones, and namely before 1970, when Thompson and Ritchie, McIlroy, and Osana developed the PDP-7 edition. Amazingly, this kernel was 2,500 lines, a complete operating systems kernel written in assembly language, not in a high-level language. As Stephen Johnson quipped, I've written bootloaders that were shorter than your variable names. And despite this diminutive size, we had very important architectural things there. First of all, layering and partitioning. The commands call the kernel does not depend on the commands, and the commands are not coupled together. We also see some primitive partitioning by naming. So the system, the kernel is named with S, and the editor starts with E at some point here, the two files comprising the editor. We had process management in terms of the fork system call, which survives until today. Descriptor management, so two routines, fget and fput, that allow us to get and return file descriptors. We had the separation of file data metadata from file naming, the inode principle, which exists until today and allows us, for example, to rename a file even though it is read by another process. Some systems, modern systems today, amazingly cannot do that. I see some laptops that use them. We have devices appearing as files, a remarkable breakthrough. Here you see them defined in assembly language. A file I/O API with system calls that we use today and they are available in most programming languages. A file system API to manipulate those files in the file system, and even an interpreter. At least two system commands, the indentation command and the lowercase conversion command, are written in a relatively high-level language, namely B, which is implemented as a threaded code interpreter. It is part of the indentation program written in B. The first system actually called Unix ran on a PDP 1120, something like this machine. Here is the architecture that reconstructed for this system. I will come back to it later on after we cover these 50 years, so it's important to keep this in mind. This featured a binary API through numbers, so for example exit is a system call number one, and amazingly these numbers survive until today. So if you look at the source code of FreeBSD 11, a modern development coming from this source code, it has the same system call numbers, you see them here, and they even survive in systems that do not share the same code base, such as Linux. It also had the shell available as a user program. Up until that time, systems, the shell was coupled, tightly coupled to the kernel. Here it is a separate process. It abstracted standard I/O, what we use today through input and output redirection. No pipes at that point, but abstracting it was a key to developing pipes later on. And it established interoperability through documented file formats. So file formats were documented in manual pages, and here you can see various clients of those file formats. So the archive file format was used by the archiver, and the loader, or the directory file format, was used by all those programs. There was no API for that. There was just documented file formatting. We went and changed the files that represented directories. It had user-contributed tools and games. This resided in a separate area of the system called /usr. Some of us still see it today. Interestingly, to force people to document it, there was a cron script that looked for documentation for every such command, and if it wasn't documented, it went and deleted it. Very interesting concept. Tree directory structure, two system calls, make directory and change directory, and a number of commands that are based on these system calls. And a mountable file system interface. This seems like a luxury, but it avoided the ugliness of drives and device, which still haunt us today in some other systems I will not name. The second research edition in 1972 featured a software library, so some routines that were available for everybody to use. And if you look, some of us, of these are still available today, which shows the power of some well-chosen utility functions. The third research edition, 1973, brought to life a dream that Doug McIlroy spelled out almost 10 years early, 1964, who said that we need a way to connect processes and couple them together, like a garden hole. So one should be able to link them together, one following the other. And this would allow a general composition of these processes, so pipes and filters. The fourth research edition brought with it structured programming. So the kernel was re-implemented from the PDP-11 assembly language, which was rewritten from the PDP-7 assembly language, into a language called NewB. It was about 6,300 lines. About 700 lines remained in PDP-7 assembly language, but as you see, the majority of the kernel was in B. It had just 105 functions and 50 assembly symbols, compared to about 250 global functions that were available in the first edition assembly language. So you see that this abstraction paid off, this re-implementation in a higher level language. Together with it came a language-independent API. So you see here as an example, the pipe system call, which is documented both as an assembly language interface, what we put in register 0 and register 1, and as a C language interface. Nowadays, this interface is used by a multitude of programming languages. Through the definition of header files, which are used today, it allowed data structure definition and reuse. Up until that point, people used to go and copy-paste the structure definition in their source code, but this didn't allow them to reuse and abstract the functionality, so if something changed, all programs need to be changed again. It had dynamic resource management through functions such as malloc, which we used allocated something different, not memory, but maps. And the device driver abstraction through a number of special files, such as a phototypesetter interface and the voice response unit, with a driver interface based on function pointers, so a primitive sort of object orientation. You had a pointer to a driver, and you could call open, close, or read and write methods on it. It also featured a buffer cache. Again, some constants, I found them surviving with the same name in modern FreeBSD Unix. The fifth edition came with command files, so the ability to write commands and execute them through the shell. Here's an early command file that compiles a number of programs. The sixth edition, famously documented by John Lyons in this commentary on the Unix operating system, which was taught in the University of New South Wales in Australia, offered a portable C library as a replacement for the library that was written in assembly up to that point. And we see some new routines, such as system. And as you can recognize, it influenced the design of the standard C library and also libraries of other programming languages. The seventh research edition was a hugely influential one. Some have described it as an improvement not only on its predecessors, but also on its successors. One key element of that was that it offered Unix as a virtual machine. So in a discussion between Dennis Ritchie and Steve Johnson, they said that it would be easier to port Unix as an operating system to a new piece of hardware than porting applications from Unix to a new operating system. So they would port Unix to different architectures and the programs would be available in that form. And this is what we benefit today, that the same programs can run on different laptops from supercomputers to $5 Raspberry Pis. It offered dynamic user memory allocation, so the famous or infamous malloc and free functions. This was a smash hit. 26 programs were using it. And also STDIO, the standard IO library, multiple precision library. It contained static analysis in form of lint because it was resource demanding and imprecise. It was implemented as a separate tool, not as part of the compiler. Environment variables. A key interesting thing here is that they implemented something by convention. So you could have key equals value to set a variable. And this was supported by minimal abstractions in the kernel, in the shell, and the C library. But what you can do with those variables, whether you set a path or whether you set a terminal that you are using, depends entirely on conventions, no hard locked API. Another key development on the seventh edition were the language development tools. So Lex for writing lexical analyzers, Yak for writing the grammars and the parsing functions. And these again were widely used. I found them used by 12 programs. So from Oak to BC and CPP and Struct all made use of these programs. And I think they spurned domain-specific languages. So already in the seventh edition, we find a number of languages or small languages that were based on those language development tools. Another key innovation was the file system and documented file system directory hierarchy, which again is a mark of convention over enforcement. Nobody forces you to put temporary files in /tmp, but it is used and it is useful. It was adopted by other systems such as Linux, for example. And importantly, the documented hierarchy contains all parts for the system to be self-hosted. So both the compiler and the source code are there. Development tools, libraries, documentation, everything is within this hierarchy. From that point onwards, no new additions came out of Bell Labs for a long time, but Unix moved to Berkeley. And from there, we had significant new developments. The first and second Berkeley software distributions, they were modestly called like that, were not operating system distributions, but software packages. But they brought forward the idea of a software package based on the established directory hierarchy and the make tool. They created the distributed tools such as those that you see here. The third Berkeley software distribution introduced a major advancement, virtual memory paging. As you see, it was a large part of the kernel of the source code, almost 20% of the source code, and also added some new system calls, such as vread and vwrite. We see here a violation of abstraction. I will come later on to discuss it as a form of technical debt. The fourth Berkeley distribution brought with it a regular expression library. At that point, at least five implementations of regular expressions were embedded in different programs. But it wasn't a success of malloc and free. I found just one client using it, the Moore program. And by 4.3, another two programs were using it. Almost 30 years later, only four replacements were made. Those four programs you see here, Ed, Grep, Sed, and Expr, were using the modern regular expression library. So we see that although it was implemented as a library, it was very difficult to get traction. They also offered optimized screen handling to allow diverse devices from teletype writers to glass terminals to use it, and we still benefit from that in that the sense that we use terminal emulators on our Macs, for example, in order to program using an interface that is based on this. 4.2 BSD was also extremely influential because it offered the Internet Protocol family, local and remote inter-process communication, database access for various parts that were needed in order to organize the network connections, and also a pseudo-terminal driver, which allows the creation of software-controlled terminal-like devices, the terminal emulators that we use today. We can see another form of technical debt here. They implemented a very large number of system calls. But as you can see, these system calls were not used a lot. So some were used by a number of programs, others by very few programs, although quite a number of programs were developed on them. Another release that came out of Berkeley, an advancement of 4.3, was the Tahoe release, which offered multiple CPU architecture support for the VAX, which was already available, and another one, the Tahoe architecture, and also time zone handling. This is important because it was contributed by another party. It was a group of volunteers contributed that code. It was not developed within Berkeley. And it separated the rules from the code. The Reno edition came with a packet forwarding database, so it allowed the implementation of network routing daemons within the user space and allowed innovation in that space and many devices that are used today to route internet packet are based on this idea. And it also offered a virtual file system interface where the layering allows the creation of very sophisticated topologies and very corresponding functionalities. Again, you see here an object-oriented interface based on not on the device driver abstraction, but on the virtual node with things like lookup, create, access, read, write, sync, and so on. The Net2 distribution offered stream IO functions and abstraction over the file input-output interface. Again, this is another example of an interface that was difficult to get traction. 30 years later, only very few programs are using it, despite GNU offering a similar functionality. 4.4 offered stackable file systems and a generic system control interface. Again, I consider this a form of technical debt. It remains in architectural limbo until today, offering unstructured access to over 3,000 values. Based on that, by that point, most of the code was replaced by code that was written at the university, which was available freely. So two volunteers created 386 BSD, an open source derivative that replaced some proprietary files with open source implementation. It was a remarkable breakthrough that we had an open source implementation of that. Unfortunately, they did not integrate the changes as fast as the community would like. But based on that, a group of volunteers created a set of patch kits, which organized community distributions and transformed 386 BSD from an open source software into an open source project where people could contribute data in an organized way. So they could contribute patches with a title, an author, description and prerequisites, and people could apply the patches as they saw fit. Based on that, FreeBSD was born, where a number of other contributions took place. So in 1.1, we see a package manager, an ability to organize and add facilities, which allowed to grow the functionality in diverse directions, from graphics to games, without excessively burdening the operating system core. This happens until today in all modern systems, and we see a proliferation of package managers. 2BSD offered a process subsystem and dynamically rollable kernel modules. It was again a huge success. Almost 1,000 modules exist today, implementing things from device drivers to file systems to emulators to system calls. 2.1 offered Linux emulation, packet capture library. 3.0, a common access method subsystem for communicating with sophisticated storage devices. What we see here, interestingly, is a small architecture of this subsystem. And this is similar also to the graph-based kernel networking user library, NetGraph, which was became available in FreeBSD 3.4. 4.0 integrated OpenSSL, a huge amount of code, almost 200,000 lines of code with the libraries and the clients, and also a jail, a facility to isolate the process. We see it used today through, for example, Docker containers, and also access control list. I will explain later on why this is a form of technical debt. Another module that has its own architecture was added in 5.0, the geometry modular disk IO request transformation framework. The kernel was radically restructured to move from a giant lock to offer symmetrical multiprocessing. And also at that time, we added developers added mandatory access control and pluggable authentication modules. 5.3 offered the streaming archive access library, a mini port driver wrapper, which allowed you to take drivers from, say, Windows and run them under FreeBSD. 6.2, another form of auditing, basic security module auditing. 7 added a file system called ZFS that was implemented by Sun in Solaris, and also dynamic tracing. 9.0 paravirtualized I/O InfiniBand support. 10 virtual machine monitor and fast user space handling. And 11 network blacklisting. Let's move to quantitative results, what we found. If we look at the user commands, we see a constant rise over the decades. If we look at system calls, we see periods of stagnation at Bell Labs, at Berkeley, and then a rise in the open source world. Perhaps everybody wanted to establish there some contributions, whereas there we had some parsimony initially with a rise. In C library functions, we see a similar picture, stability followed by a rise. In devices, we see a constant rise because of, obviously, hardware external pressure through new devices. In file formats, we see a stagnation here. Probably the file format, documented file format, is not serving us today with more complex requirements that we have. And we also see a rise in system commands and in kernel interfaces. If we look at the cyclomatic complexity, we see an interesting picture in both commands, the library and the kernel, where we see a rise and then a fall again, which means that there were some corrective measures implemented after some point. Interestingly, we saw this also mirrored in the GNU Linux kernel, the GNU C library, and the GNU core utils, similar rises and falls. This qualitative and quantitative evaluation allowed us to propose a theory of architectural evolution. So let me finish by describing 11 propositions regarding this theory. The first 4 concern the form and pace of evolution. Many core decisions are taken at the beginning of the system's lifetime, so at this point Unix was really formed. But most architectural decisions survive over the system's lifetime. So this is everything that is documented in the manual pages. And as you see in the end, most end up as blue. So they survive until the end. About 12 out of 15,000 documented facilities. More dramatically, if you look at the architecture of the first edition, look at the colored boxes. These are things that were implemented at that time. Now squint your eyes and look at FreeBSD 11. And we see that all those parts remain until today. So architectural form has largely remained stable, especially in the areas where technologies, new technologies weren't involved. Nevertheless, new architectural decisions are continuously made, further fueling architecture evolution, but the rate of architectural decision declines over the system's lifetime. So what was implemented the first 10 years is almost equivalent to what was implemented the next 45. The next 2 concern architectural depth. We found that many decisions offering features that are similar to existing ones or are underused are some forms of architectural depth. So nowadays we have many system calls that do similar things, such as reading stuff, many things for logging, many ways to deal with permissions, both threads and processes for architecture, for multitasking. But nevertheless, depth is systematically paid back despite this increasing system size and complexity. Finally, regarding the forces of architectural evolution, these are the last 5 propositions that I have to make. These concern, first of all, the use of conventions instead of enforcement. These facilitate evolution by minimizing effort and offering flexibility in terms of text files, for example. Directory hierarchy, you can model it in any way you want. Documented file formats and environment variables. All these are largely based on conventions. The other idea is that portability, due to its complexity, is a key driver of architectural evolution. So the need for portability from PDP 7 to 11 to the VAX to Tahoe to 386 brought about the C programming language, device drivers, scripting, layers, partitions, and virtual interface abstractions. Another thing that we saw is that an ecosystem of other operating systems nowadays and third parties shapes the architectural evolution. So modern FreeBSD 11 has huge subsystems, millions of lines of code contributed by third parties and other operating systems. It doesn't happen, everything does not happen within the FreeBSD community. And we also see it through third party influences. So things, millions or hundreds of thousands of codes come out of efforts such as NetBSD or Linux or Juniper Networks or Illuminos and OpenSolaris and even Apple. Also, third-party subsystems facilitate this evolution through code use, but they add technical depth. So every time a major subsystem comes, it comes with its own libraries, its own facilities, so there is less reuse at that point at the architecture, at the operating system level. There is duplication of functionality. And finally, large subsystems form their own independent architecture. I showed you three examples through NetGraph, SSL, Mac, Geom, and ZFS and S-Trace. So now we're growing to a federated architecture rather than a monolithic architecture with its own conceptual integrity as was in the beginning. And this, recoup to the beginning, brings me to the end. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, we have plenty of time for questions.
Question. So what was the reason for basically the development being stopped at Bell Labs and everything moving to Berkeley and sort of being continued at Berkeley? What was the reason for the development basically moving away from Bell Labs and going to Berkeley? Is it that people moved sort of from Bell Labs to start their careers at Berkeley, or there were some other reasons, if mm-hmm. you know, obviously?
What was the reason? First of all, it did not stop. It just dramatically slowed down, so it appeared as if stopped. Two new research editions came out, the 9th and the 10th, and Plan 9. At that point, the people at Bell Labs, I think, considered that most of the research work was done. Further developments were more engineering effort. They want to experiment with radically new ideas, as what happened in Plan 9. And this perhaps were not taken more by the community. So it's not that it stopped or slowed, but the take up from the community and many things that we now consider interesting happened in systems that were widely used in universities. So it's that interesting work happened in universities rather than that work stopped at Bell Labs. People were moving between universities and Bell Labs continuously on the time, and this can be seen in the source code, where some things magically appear in Bell Labs code or in Berkeley code, as if there was an underground tunnel between Bell Labs and Berkeley, a very long one. Yes?
You had a slide where you talked about some overlapping commands, read, period, and some other commands.
Mm-hmm.
So I didn't understand the last one. What did you mean by threads and processes? You mean they're overlapping? Or?
Yes, they offer the same similar facility, some parts of code operating together. So if one looked at conceptual integrity, if people were designing today an operating system, maybe they would offer just one form for code working concurrently. That could be perhaps based on threads or on multitasking, and perhaps another orthogonal facility for process isolation. But nowadays we have two and they sit awkwardly together. If you look at Linux and the process listing, you see threads and processes intermix, and you have a different facility in the kernel, again, thread kernel tasks. This does not look at the conceptual integrity design.
Thank you.
So if you were doing a new operating system from scratch now, which things would you keep and what would you, I guess more importantly, what would you get rid of?
Right. So this brings me back to the technical depth question in form of functionality. I think it's very difficult to develop an operating system from scratch today because the bar is extremely high. So at the time, the key architectural decisions of Unix were made, there was the area was completely uncharted, so it was easy to innovate and offer a design that had extreme power. Nowadays, maybe one would, or I would think of looking at the microkernel ideas based on what is available today. So at the time microkernels were developed, maybe the hardware was not ripe enough and advanced enough, but maybe nowadays, if we looked at these ideas again, could design a small enough kernel that would allow to layer existing facilities on top of it in a way that would allow us to create a usable operating system.
Thank you. That was a tour de force of Unix history. Really enjoyed it. I think you're suggesting that the proliferation of features, your kind of bar graphs where we see this great rise in features, is a social issue, perhaps. But then you said that the kind of self-correcting in terms of the complexity is a kind of emergent feature. What would you attribute that to? How does this correction take place?
Right. So we have two things. One is this proliferation of features. So people, when Unix moved to Berkeley, people decided to add many system calls in order, of course, to support networking functionality, but perhaps also one could say to add their mark. And again, this seems to be happening in the open source community. But we see here this rise and fall in cyclomatic complexity. I also looked with some colleagues on other language features, and it seems that people went over the top by using some things or weren't careful enough, for example, the use of GoTo. And at some point, they went down and trimmed down, so decided it's wrong that using preprocessor macros or GoTo or creating large functions is not such a good idea. I think it became easier over the time as they had more powerful computers to create larger functions, because the function calling overhead was less. At some point, they realized that this brought a different type of cost in the terms of functions that were not modular enough. Hardware became stronger, so the function call overhead was not as an impediment as it used to be. Screens became larger, so editing was easier. It's no joke programming on a teletype writer, where you hear a click every time and every character you type is actually printed on paper. And so they could again perform these corrections. And we see it as a fall in the use of the GoTo, for example, or functions becoming smaller, variable names becoming longer. So these are very concrete things. And also on a more macroscopic scale, this fall in cyclomatic complexity, which, as I say, we also see in the Linux and the GNU community.
So actually, I have a related question to that one. So is the drop in the complexity due to basically better code being produced, or there have been some maybe not concentrated but significant cases of like basically going and refactoring existing code in the kernel? And if you observe this while studying the history.
Mm-hmm. What is the role of refactoring in this fall in cyclomatic complexity? It is mainly due to the addition of new, better code. So some minor refactoring has taken place over the year, mainly to use new language facilities, such as void, structures in the early days, the header files, as I said, stronger types, even in C. But these were minimal in some specific areas or things that could be done automatically or very jarring to the eyes. But no major refactorings have been done globally in code. There's too much legacy code. But as code gets added by the millions of lines, of course, newer, better code shows better results here.
All right, so I have a couple of questions. So actually, the first one, short one, is what happened around year 2000? Because most of these cyclomatic complexities go uh-huh. down around that time. Just curious.
Okay, I have to guess here. It's not. Yeah. I haven't looked at it in depth. I would say C, the C programming language, maturing through standardization, and allowing people becoming more aware of it. But that's just a guess. That's a very interesting question. Yeah.
And the second one is, from this study, I guess another trend in computer science was getting more solid methodologies for testing, more solid methodologies for program analysis, and better tools for all of these tasks. So any insights on how the design of the operating system would change in order to support better analyzability in comparison with simplicity that started from the perspective of people being sure that things still work correctly by looking at the code?
So the question is, how is stronger methodologies are going to affect or have affected the system?
Yes, yes.
I would not say a lot. So for example, if we look at testing code, it started appearing at Berkeley, but it's not a percentage that we see in modern applications written in dynamic languages, for example. So there is some testing going on, but not to the extent that we see it, certainly not large coverage through unit tests, for example.
All right, thank you. One final question.
Oh, great. All right. Thanks. So that was fascinating. I was wondering, have you had a chance to look at any other long-running open source projects? I don't even know if there's another one that is as long-running. Like, it just blows my mind that any piece of code could survive for 50 years, and any architectural decision could survive for 50 years. And I'm wondering, were they just really brilliant, and they made some really good decisions, or are there things that we can learn from it?
Mm-hmm. So what's the comparison with other systems? Some years ago, I did a comparison between four operating system kernels, Windows, the Unix kernel, Solaris, which was spawned from Linux, but was developed as a proprietary system, and Linux. And I looked at the quality side, and remarkably, all had similar levels of code quality in various dimensions. So I think that when you have to develop something that's as complex as an operating system kernel, the requirements, the engineering requirements drive the quality of the code you are writing and architectural decisions.